Testing. All right, there we go. Hey, welcome everyone. You guys made it to week 8 of Theology Essentials. And tonight's a special night for a couple of reasons. Number one, you get to hear Jeff Moore talk about eschatology, which is so fun. And number two, we've got a few of you who we get to celebrate as graduates of the Equip Institute. So we've got 3 classes. Some of you, this might be your first, some of this might be your second, but for those of you for whom it is your third, we've got a little bit of a surprise, a gift for you just to recognize the fact that you've been through all 3 classes. And so what we'd love to do is I'm gonna call everybody's name one at a time, those of you who are graduates, have you come up. We've got a diploma for you, and we've also got a small gift, but I'll have you come up, grab your diploma, and then everybody who's a graduate, we're gonna just have you stand up here until the whole group is up, and we're gonna take a group photo. Sound good? Okay. All right, so first up is Shelley Onspa. I'm probably saying that wrong. Okay. Thank you so much for being part of the Institute. And then, and we're going to give you your gift after you walk off, and we've gotten the photo. And then second, we've got Ian Brenneman. Is Ian here? Oh, yes, perfect. All right, and then next we have Russ Dennis. Yeah. There you go. And Christy Ivy, and then Trey Ivy, who I assume you guys are sitting next to each other. As Stacy Levan. There we go. Yes, make sure you keep it upright for the photo. And we've got JP McBride. And Donna Poveda. And then Gustavo Poveda. And next we have Lindley Prophet. You're welcome. And Steve Prophet. Perfect. And then last but certainly not least, we have Daryl Tinker. Also possibly on his way. Well, we've got Rob in the back if you want to take a photo. There we go. As we take this photo, just want to again just say thank you to everybody who's part of these classes. We love having you here, but you guys are the reason we do this, and it's been a lot of fun. All right. And then if you all want to come over here, we've got a small gift for you. And then we'll get going in the class here in just a moment.
I feel like we need the Price is Right music playing right now or something. That'd be... Dun, 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 dun. Go ahead and
just hold it down. Yes. It's a color. There you go. Yes, thank you. All right, and then I'm going to let Jeff kick us off in prayer.
Yep, sounds good. Yeah, let me pray for us as our graduates find their seat. God, thanks for tonight and a chance to talk about, just more about who you are and what you do and how you do it and what you've revealed to us about that. And pray tonight, God, prevent me from saying anything untrue, intentionally or unintentionally. God, help our students to not hear anything that's untrue intentionally or unintentionally. God, help us to love you better and understand you just a little bit more, maybe in a little while than we do right now. And we just pray this, Jesus, in your name. Amen. I was telling Rob, who was taking pictures, this is the third year of the Institute, so this would be our seventh graduation. Yeah, seventh graduating class kind of thing, just the way the classes roll out. This is literally the first time we've had the forethought to go, hey, what if we got a picture of all the graduates? So we're learning. We're learning as we go. So thank you guys for pressing through and taking all of them. I don't know if you guys know Bob and Deborah Reedy. They've actually graduated from the Institute twice. They came the first year and liked it so much they came back an entire second year. So if you just didn't get all the itches scratched this year, feel free to take all three classes again. There's no rules against that. We saw a few of y'all have already signed up for apologetics in the fall, which is awesome. It helps us know how to plan. So if you're thinking about doing that, make sure you get your signups in. And we'll take it a little more public as the summer rolls along. And that class always fills up pretty quick. So don't snooze too long. What things have stood out to you guys over the last 7 weeks? What have been some of the big takeaways? Yes, sir. No, you can't regroup them in one sitting. That is a true statement. That's true. No, you're fine. You're among friends with that statement, I'm pretty sure. Really? What was it about the Trinity that stood out? Yeah. It's amazing. It seems like every month there's at least one or two new books that try to unpack it a little more intelligible. And that, I mean, been going at this now for 2,000 years, and they're still trying to say it clearer and clearer and clearer. Yeah, that's good. Yes, sir.
There were some chapters the book I'm only to 47. I haven't completed. But there are some chapters I did not like at all, but I love his chapter on creation.
Okay.
I think he treated creation very fair, right? Young or older.
Yeah. Yeah. If you go back, Brad did a series in Genesis back in 2013 to 2014. And the very first week, obviously, he has to deal with the creation account. And that was one of my first series that we did once I started working here. And I just remember almost a relief it was for people to hear, here's the five or six primary ways creation is understood biblically, theologically, historically, scientifically, all this kind of thing. All these are within the realm of orthodoxy. So everybody take a deep breath. It's going to be okay. You know, that kind of thing. It might not be quite as tight and rigid as we want to make it.
He updated that chapter, I'm sure, from whatever his previous.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I had read a couple of those sure. stuff, and he had the latest that I agree
sure.
with.
Sure. Well, yeah, and so.
He pointed out the challenges with creating evolution, with theistic evolution.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Now you got some real challenges.
Sure.
He just does a very good job.
No, and that's a key to a good systematic. And this, I mean, all cards on the table. Grudem's not the best systematic theology you'll ever read. There are much better ones out there, and I'm happy to give you some suggestions for that. But as far as just getting all the big hitters in there and talking about the main things that most people are really going to benefit from, he really does a outstanding job. Not that we agree with everything he says, because we don't agree with what we ourselves say sometimes, right? And when you think about it later. So it's not that you have to agree with 100% of it to take it seriously and appreciate it. But yeah, I think Grudem's good. We were actually going to go with his original version of that. And as we were planning the first year of this is when they announced the second edition. So we were literally hurry up and come out with it. And it came out just a few weeks before the first class of this that we did. So we were glad that we waited because he really did expand a lot of stuff. Did you say you've read up to chapter 47? I didn't want to just blow by that too quick. I want everybody to appreciate that for a second. What else? This is good. This is last night, so say it if you got it on your mind right now. Yes, sir. Yeah. Sure. Yeah. Yeah. Sure. 100%. Yeah, most of us are going to fall in one or two camps as we think everything is a debate. everything that's brought up, or you're not aware that anything is debated. You just assume that the church you grew up in, that's what everybody believes, right? And so when you start kind of digging into this, that can catch you off guard if you're not careful. So yeah, no, that's good. And like we've talked about that primary, secondary, and tertiary stuff, you know, when you can learn how to bracket the conversation and, okay, what are we actually talking about here? Is this something that we need to argue about, or can we just agree to disagree, or do we really need to talk about this at all? You know, I mean, there's a lot of freedom in that too. Yeah. One more person. All right, Steve. He said he was amazed at how much sin was explored in Grudem, I assume. Yeah, for sure. One of my profs at Dallas, Dr. Glenn Kreider, that's his least favorite class to teach, he told us, because it's like it's just so dark. So like they pair hamartiology with like angelology, which would include like demonology and all that stuff, you know, and so it's like he feels like for an entire semester he's just talking about the dark underbelly of everything that we believe kind of thing. But it's like you don't get to the good news until you just realize just how dark that really is. And yeah, it's pretty fascinating. Well, that's good. I mean, it sounds like you guys have dug in a little bit and read, and you're absorbing it. That's the cool thing. And the reminder is that this is just your starting point. What we tried to provide you, because like I told you, it's like we're not going to nail down the Trinity in an hour and 15 minute lecture, right? Or, you know, 100 hour and 15 minute lectures. The idea is to just expose yourself more and more to kind of what's out there. You know, what are the things being talked about that have been talked about for, you know, millennia, or what's being talked about today? Because it's all a part of how the church continues to view herself, continue to grow, continue to recontextualize the gospel for each new generation. You know, we're coming in now. We've got another group of young people that are going to come up with a whole different set of questions. So we need to nail down the questions, right, and nail down the issues that we have in our generation so that we're prepared to absorb the next round that's coming. And that kind of brings us to eschatology a little bit, because eschatology is really, at the end of the day, all about where all this is going, okay? And so, well, let me just ask you a question. What do you think about, when you hear the word eschatology, what immediately comes to mind for you? End times. There you go. Revelation. Yep. Jesus is coming. She just gets right to the point. She's like, I'll just boil it down for you. That's good. So those three things are very important. We have a very important, very well, at least popularized book of the Bible. We have kind of the point of the whole thing, that Jesus is coming back. The end time, so there's the academic understanding of it. So how does it function, though, in the church? Like, if those things are true, and those things are there, and we know those things, does any of that play into the church that you go to, or have gone to, or observe? Paul's like, I don't know. Never thought about it before. Yeah. We'll get there. We'll get there. You'll be surprised, but we'll get there. Yeah. So, you know, so how do people, or you typically view eschatology? So typically, you know, when it's brought up, this is just a casual Google search. It's funny, the stuff that came up when you talk about eschatology, most people think of one of four things, and that's it's a waste of time. It's not worth talking about anytime. It just leads to arguments. It's something that is just speculative, was another thing. Like, nobody really knows. Yeah, the Bible says this, but nobody really knows. Hadn't happened yet. There's arguments about it. The argument word keeps coming up a lot if you Google views of eschatology, like popular views of eschatology. One is it's not worth studying, was another common one that I found. So, yes, there's this whole category at the back of Grudem that is way past chapter 47, I would imagine. I don't know how many chapters are in Grudem, but it's like, I'm tired of reading by the time I get that far. You know, it's at the end. It's the end times. It's also the end of whatever book you happen to be reading, right? So they don't even get there, so it's not really worth studying. But the other extreme of not worth it at all, I love this phrase, was newspaper exegesis, which is basically looking at the newspaper today and trying to connect all the dots from what you see on Twitter or the New York Times or the Washington Post or whatever and try to map it back onto Scripture somehow. We talked about that a little bit in the Revelation class, I think, but just this idea of using your newspaper to exegete Scripture. That's never necessarily a good idea. So here's the thing. So if we're going to talk about tonight, you don't have to have a position on everything, eschatologically speaking. But hopefully the desire from tonight is that you will at least develop a desire to have a few views that you hold to and are willing to continue to question and, you know, look at with fresh eyes from time to time and listen to good teaching. But, you know, that you'll want to dial in a few things. So good eschatology, fairly simply, is the result of good Bible study. And eschatology completes the grand narrative of Scripture. And that's hopefully something that you'll see tonight as we talk. There's a guy named Michael Byrd. In fact, he has a systematic theology I'd highly recommend if you want a second large book to set on your shelf. It's a $25, $30 book. It's called Evangelical Theology or something to that effect if you want it. But he makes a statement that all of theology is an eschatology in the process of being realized. You remember last week at the end, I used that phrase that I read that day about the Bible is eschatological in its teleology, that the direction of Scripture from Genesis 1:1 to the end is all about how God is taking all this somewhere. Like there's a plan that he's working out. And when you talk about a plan that's being worked out with we are here and the fulfillment of the plan is out there, you're already talking about eschatology, whether you know it or not. And so you can't get around it. Like you're going to be involved in eschatological thinking and Bible study and all that kind of stuff, whether or not you're even aware of it. But, you know, again, it's important to remember that everything in eschatology is important, but everything isn't equally important. So we get back to that first tier, second tier, scheme where you have to know kind of which category you're talking about so you know just how much energy and, you know, yeah, how much energy to put into it, right? So, so when we talk about eschatology, what are some primary, secondary, and tertiary things? So primary things would be things like the bodily return of Jesus. Okay, that's a primary eschatological view. Christians for 2,000 years, since the angel said that this Jesus whom you saw ascend will return in the same way. From that point forward, there is no way around that being an orthodox thing, right? So does that make sense? The Bible said it. It's very clear. So we are expectant of that happening. So if somebody says, I don't think Jesus is going to bodily return. If all of a sudden Brad starts teaching that Jesus isn't going to physically come back, that's when you got to say, hey, I need to get a meeting with the elders to talk about that, right? Because that's an orthodox thing that Brad thankfully would never say. But, you know, the outcome of God's plan of redemption and the final judgment is also primary. Like, we know from Scripture that that is a truth that we are expectant of, okay? Even though it hadn't happened yet, we know from the overall witness of Scripture that that is going to happen. So that's primary. Secondary would be things like our view of the thousand-year reign. And we'll get later to some of the views of that. I can't remember if it was in some of y'all's reading this week. But, you know, things like the, you know, what your view of the thousand years is, the timing of Christ's return, the fact that Christ is coming back, primary. When he's coming back and all that, that's secondary. Because there's all different ways to kind of come at that depending on how you read other parts of Scripture. And then tertiary things would be things like the rapture, the sequence of events in the book of Revelation, you know, so how you read, you know, we talked about in the class on that, whether it's a sequential thing or recapitulation thing that we see, you know, those types of things are eschatology, they're eschatological in how they're framed, but you can agree to disagree any number of ways on those issues. So I think that's enough about that. So where we're going tonight, I'll break it down into two sections. The first is eschatology, and eschatological language in the Old and New Testaments. I want you to walk out of here having seen and heard different passages, different verses that speak eschatologically. So you start to see some, you know, phrases and words and things so that when you see them in your own time with God, that you can't ignore them anymore. You kind of know what they're talking about. And the second part will just be various various viewpoints, okay? So we'll get into a little bit of the nuts and bolts of how a lot of different scholars, theologians, Bible teachers arrive at certain conclusions about eschatology. So the hope is that you'll have a better understanding, not just of the things that people like to talk about or how they can be confusing about eschatology, but at the end of the day, you'll have a grasp on how the Bible talks about the things to come, the end times, as he said earlier. So make a few recommendations to you. It'd be great if my computer would cooperate. It's not gonna. Oh, that's fun. Let's see. Hang on. There we go. These three books, I'll borrow fairly heavily from some of these tonight. Anthony Hokema, The Bible in the Future. If you just want one book on your shelf that is very readable, like it's written at a popular level style, but it's written from a very thorough theological bent, very, very handy on your shelf. Eschatological Discipleship by Trevin Wax is a couple years old, but it's really good at just making eschatology practical for how we help others grow in their knowledge and following of the Lord. So, in this last one, this is a series exploring Christian theology. Michael Spiegel, who's one of our profs at Dallas, Nathan Holstein, who used to be there, Dr. Kreider, helped write some of these. There's like a three-book series, but this one is called The Church, Spiritual Growth in the End Times. Is a really good, just, again, quick grab. It gives you primary passages to master, certain verses that, you know, really help paint a clear overarching picture of Scripture and how it speaks of eschatology. It gives you, again, kind of the primary views. So this would be a very abbreviated version of this. So if you want to do more of a deep dive, get that one. If you want to do more of a, hey, I just want 35 pages that really help me understand it a little better, I get this one. So, but yeah, that way I don't have to tell you each time I'm saying it tonight that I'm borrowing it from somebody. I'm telling you right now, a lot of stuff I'm saying I'm borrowing from those three books. So, let's see. So why do we need eschatology? This is something that Trevin Wax says in that book. And it says that divorced from eschatology, discipleship may lead us to adopt personal, interior-focused practices, but fail to give sufficient attention to the kind of spiritual formation that helps us recognize the present context and our role in it. One of the things he says in the book a lot is, you know, a good eschatology helps us remember what time it is, okay? It's a kind of a phrase he uses a lot. Likewise, eschatology divorced from a larger vision of discipleship, or eschatology reduced to debates about the timing of Christ's return, etc., may lead us to an inordinate focus on historical and interpretive curiosities rather than sound exegesis that helps us discern the Bible's overarching vision of the world and our future. Because that's the big thing about any of these ologies, is they can become the focus versus what they're designed to help us focus better on, which is the God who's revealed himself through Scripture, through his Son, and his work in the world by the church, right? So that's what all this leads us back to. So anytime we get focused, and this is where a lot of scholars get sideways with the church sometimes, they get so focused on the academic side that they forget why. Right? So we never want to look at any of these ologies we've talked about the last few weeks, you know, taken out of the context of person to person, helping each other grow, iron sharpening iron, that sort of thing. So, but again, Wax is big on just kind of pointing out that, you know, just continuing to drill down, you know, what time is it? We live between Christ's first advent and his second advent. So that means we still have work to do until he comes back. So that's what time it is, right? So eschatology helps us do that. Let's see here. Nope. My slides are not behaving right now. Hang on 2 seconds. We're about to jump out of some slides because they're not that important. So, where is it? Yes, skip that. We're running short on time here. Okay, so this is where your class notes start. So what is eschatology? There we go, right there. Excuse me. Eschatology. Okay, we have to define it. I think the definition's there on your notes. But there's two Greek words, eschatos and logos, meaning the doctrine of last things or thinking about last things. It's generally understood to refer to events that are still to happen, both in relation to us as individuals and to the world. So, you know, what relates to us as individuals? Things like, you know, what happens when we die. Right? That would be an eschatological category, okay? So, you know, what, you know, the the eternal existence of the soul. That's an eschatological category that a lot of times we don't think about because it doesn't have anything to do with angels and trumpets and all that. When we talk about what happens when we die, we're talking eschatology. So every time you go to a funeral, you're in an eschatological event, is a way to think about it. So, but there's three categories, and we won't do a deep dive on these tonight, but these are things that I just want you to kind of have as a frame of reference. There's three four types: personal eschatology, general, future, and inaugurated eschatology. So just quickly what those are. Personal eschatology, again, concerns things like what happens when we die, personal resurrection, eternal life. Okay, already talked about that. General eschatology is with respect to the end of the world, the return of Christ, general resurrection, final judgment, things like that. Future eschatology is exactly what it sounds like, things that are spoken of in Scripture, but they haven't happened yet, okay? And then inaugurated eschatology is kind of a blend of those things. It's, if you've ever heard that phrase, which if you've been in these classes, you definitely have, the already not yet. That's inaugurated. Like, God promised something, and it's happened, but not to the fullest extent yet, right? So we're indwelt by God's Spirit now, but we're not fully sanctified yet. That makes sense? So there's the seal and guarantee of the Spirit in us, but the Spirit hadn't finished his work in us. So that's the idea of the kind of inaugurated aspect, because when will we be ultimately perfected? It's when we die, right, and go to be with Christ. So that's the, again, already not yet. So personal, general, future, and inaugurated. So like we said, it's the last thing in your Grudem book. It means the last things, or doctrine of the last things. So one of the reasons isn't just sequentially from a when things happen in real-time standpoint, but eschatology really is like the culmination of everything that's built up till now. So for instance, each member of the Trinity, if you read through the book of Revelation, each member of the Trinity carries out specific roles. Well, you only understand that all three of these people that are carrying out these roles, you only understand that if you've already kind of adopted an understanding and gained an understanding that God is one God in three persons, right? So our understanding of man and sin reminds us that of why God is going, or what God is going to do in the future, and why it's such a glorious ending to the story, right? If we don't understand what sin is, then we don't really understand this movement, that kind of four-part framework. Remember we talked about in the story of Scripture class, the fact that, you know, God created, that there was a fall, that there's this plan of redemption that's being worked out to a glorious future and in this consummation. So understanding salvation and its results helps us not just worship God for how we use our gifts, worship God for what he has done in sending Jesus and saving us, but it also gives direction to how we use our gifts and then participate in his mission to spread the gospel to the ends of the earth. So when you look at Acts and the epistles, you see God's unfolding plan of redemption. You know, Jesus told the disciples to do this. They're doing this, not just in fulfillment of what God planned to do, but in obedience to what Jesus told them to do. Well, they're thinking eschatologically. Before Jesus comes back, he told us to do something, and we better get after it, right? So, and then finally, a good eschatology reminds us that all this is going somewhere and that the work we have is not in vain. So it just reminds us that because God has been faithful to accomplish what he said he would do up until now, we have a confident hope that what Scripture reveals as the end of all things will also be accomplished. So eschatology reminds us that God is good and that God is powerful and God has a plan. God's going to complete that plan, but God's going to use us as he does that. And so eschatology is the backdrop for all that, but it is the culmination of all the other stuff that you've studied up till now. So time is it? Good. We're doing good. Okay, so I told you I want you to kind of get your bearings in Scripture. So we tend to think a lot of times of eschatology as kind of a New Testament thing, but a lot of that is just because we don't know how to read the Old Testament with eschatological lenses. Okay, so I just want to take you through some stuff, and there's a whole list of verses in your notes there, I think, on page 2. Yeah, so what I wanted us to do is just read through some of those. Not all of them, but I've got some just kind of pulled out that I think are kind of key. But one thing to observe and reflect on is that, you know, this always fascinates me to think about this, is that we're waiting for the second return of Jesus now the way those in the Old Testament were waiting for the first coming of Jesus. So that tension that we feel right now of, hey, God promised something. When's it going to happen? You know, that the apostles were expecting in their day, you know, in the AD 60s, 50s, 60s, they were expecting it. Now in the 80s, 2023s, we're still expecting it. It's like, what's going on? That's how Isaiah would have felt. That's how Jeremiah would have felt. That's how Moses would have felt when he said, you know, one day God will raise up a prophet, or I will raise up a prophet like you from among your brothers. Moses was like, that sounds great. When? You know? And it's always this thing that's out there, eschatology. So that's all in the Old Testament. That book by Anthony Hokema, there's a paragraph that I wanted to read. It's literally the first paragraph in one of the chapters, in the chapter Eschatological Outlook of the Old Testament. But I read this yesterday and I thought, man, this really gives us a good, kind of good compass to follow as we get into this. So let me read it for you. It's properly to understand biblical eschatology, we must see it as an integral aspect of all biblical revelation. Eschatology must not be thought of as something which is found only in, say, books as Daniel and Revelation, which are kind of the obvious ones, but is dominating and permeating the entire message of the Bible. On this point, Jürgen Moltmann, who's a theologian, certainly said correctly, from first to last, and not merely in the epilogue, Christianity is eschatology, is hope, forward-looking and forward-moving, and therefore also revolutionizing and transforming the present. The eschatological is not one element of Christianity, but it is the medium of the Christian faith as such, the key in which everything in it is set. Hence, eschatology cannot really be only a part of Christian doctrine. Rather, the eschatological outlook is characteristic of all Christian proclamation and of every Christian existence and of the whole church. So, my hope is, as we look through these scriptures, is that'll be proved true, but that you also see some things you can't unsee. So as we read some of these, I want to read them out loud. And if you just want to even just underline on your page the one I'm reading, you can go back to it and read it in your Bible on your own time. But hopefully this changes the way you read parts of scripture. So we see that, you know, the first eschatological thing we see is in Genesis 3:15, where, you know, God told the serpent, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. And this is a eschatological phrase to learn to look for. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. It's future. The seed of Abraham in Genesis 22:18, and in your offspring shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because you have obeyed my voice. So Abraham had to move on a promise that was going to be fulfilled later, but by doing that, he proved his faith, but it also put an eschatological thing in motion, right? So the descendant of Judah, Genesis 49:10, says the scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet, until tribute comes to him, and to him shall be the obedience of the people. So again, phrases like shall not, words like until, phrases like shall be, are eschatological. The coming Redeemer would be a descendant of David, 2 Samuel 7:12-13, that when your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. So you have the promise of a future thing that God will fulfill. So you have to trust in God's faithfulness to believe it, but that promise is an eschatological promise. So this coming Redeemer would be a prophet, Deuteronomy 18:15. The Lord your God, I quoted this while ago, will raise up for you a prophet like me, or Moses, from among you, from your brothers, and it is to him you shall listen. So you go on down, and you know, he's promised as a priest, you know, Psalm 110:4, promised to be a king, promised to be Emmanuel, God with us, going to be a suffering servant. You know, this is that coming Redeemer, this Messiah that they were looking for. You get to Daniel 7:13-14, and Daniel, it refers to the Son of Man, which we now know, looking back, that he was talking about Jesus. But I'll just read that verse. It says, I, Daniel, saw in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven, there came one like a Son of Man. And he came to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him. And to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. And his dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom is one that shall not be destroyed. So again, we know this is Jesus. They would have known it was talking about someone that was coming. They wouldn't know it was Jesus just yet. But they did know, because of this type of kind of foreshadowing, this eschatological promising that God was doing to his people and through his people, what type of Messiah he would be. He would be a redeemer that would be all these things, a king, a priest, a prophet, a suffering servant, all these things. So, and, you know, our week on the Trinity, I quoted Warfield is saying that the Old Testament is like a room that's richly furnished, but dimly lit. Y'all remember me saying that? This is one of those things that applies to Old Testament eschatology as well. So you don't really understand, like if you were just to start with no prior knowledge and reading in Genesis on up through Malachi, I can think of the book. You wouldn't have an understanding just yet of Jesus, but as soon as you get to Matthew, it's like, oh, that's who we've been talking about. Well, that would have been their experience too, right? So the Old Testament eschatology is made clear by what the New Testament continues to show us. So again, another theme the Old Testament picks up on, moving on to the kingdom of God. And this isn't a phrase that you find in the Old Testament, but it's more of a theme you pick up when you read things like God is king, okay? That's talking about God's kingdom. You know, God is a king over something. Well, that would be his kingdom. So key verses for that, Isaiah 43:15, that I am the Lord, your Holy One, the creator of Israel, your king, okay? Psalm 47:2, for the Lord, the Most High, is to be feared. He's a great king over all the earth. Things like that, again, speaking of God's king, his kingship, his kingdom rule, those sorts of things. The prophets looked forward to a day when God's rule will be fully experienced, not just by Israel, by the whole world. So the idea that Jesus brought this new thing, that God was going to somehow save everybody, not just the Jews, well, they understood that too when they were thinking. Clearly, in the Old Testament, they just tended to get very nationalistic from time to time and forget that what God was doing through them was to be a blessing to all nations. So you see that, for example, in Daniel 2, where Daniel's speaking of God's future kingdom, and then in 7:13-14, which we just read, when the Son of Man is giving an everlasting dominion and kingdom which shall not be destroyed. That's all, kingdom language, God's kingdom, but it's a future kingdom. Okay, another eschatological reality spoken about in the Old Testament is probably one you're a little more familiar with, called the New Covenant, Jeremiah 31:31-34. And then this is just rich with theological language, eschatological language. Let me just read it. It says, behold, the days are coming. There's that phrase. Declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, not like the covenant that I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. And it continues on a few verses later. For this is a covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And no longer shall each one teach his neighbor and each his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. So again, the New Testament, we know now that that was ushered in by Christ. We learned that from passages like Hebrews 8, I think it's 8 to 13, 1 Corinthians 11:25. So these passages in the New Testament helps us understand what the Old Testament was talking about as it pointed to this coming Messiah who would accomplish the promise that God had made. Does that make sense? So there's all this you kind of got to go back and forth a little bit to piece it all together, but once you do, it really starts to paint just a beautiful picture. So the eschatological hope of Israel ultimately was their future restoration. It wasn't just land. It wasn't just a coming Messiah. It was the restoration of all things of which they knew they were going to be a part. So, for instance, Jeremiah 23:3, God promises to gather the remnant of his flock out of all the countries where I have driven them, and I will bring them back to their fold, and they shall be fruitful and multiply. There's that creation mandate again, but you got to remember Israel's in captivity then, so even God promising to bring them out, all they know is it's going to come out, they're going to bring them out someday. So that's eschatological thinking. That's not now, it's yet to happen. That makes sense. So it's that inaugurated type of thing, or future eschatology they would have had. Another category would be the future outpouring of the Spirit, Joel 2:28-29, which Acts 2:17 affirms is the accomplishment of that promise in Joel. Promise in Joel says that, and it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons, your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. Even on the male and female servants, in those days I will pour out my spirit. In those days, in a future day, I will do this. Not now, but I promise you it will happen. That's the kind of promises we're holding on till still for today. So you can also think of the new heavens and new earth as a foreshadowing of what God's going to do, an eschatological promise. We tend to think of those just as something we see in the New Testament, in the book of Revelation, but they're actually first talked about in the Old Testament. Isaiah 65:17 says, for behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former things shall not be remembered or come into mind. And then we learn from the Hall of Faith in Hebrews 11 that all the Old Testament saints had their hope in something that was future that they had not attained, right? So their hope technically would have been an eschatological hope. Hebrews 11, 13 to 16, that these all, you know, all the saints that they had listed off, that the writer of Hebrews had listed off, having not received the things promised, but having them, having seen them and greeted them from afar, and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. For people who speak thus make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of that land from which they had gone out, they would have had the opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. So again, there's just that eschatological language that I just want you to learn to kind of look for as you read. So the last theme the Old Testament has that we're going to look at is the day of the Lord. And as opposed to just reading through a bunch of verses, because we love the Bible Project around here, and they have really great videos that explain things in really easy to understand ways. We're going to watch a video. I'm going to rest my voice, and then we'll come back and look at the New Testament together.
The day of the Lord. It's a phrase in the Bible that religious people use, usually when talking about the end of the world.
Yeah, things like Armageddon or the apocalypse. You might be familiar with this image of Jesus returning on a white horse. He's got a sword to bring final judgment.
And everyone wants to know, how will it all go down?
So a lot of these images come from the last book of the Bible, but to understand them, you have to go back to the first book.
When the story begins, we watch God create an amazing world, and then he gives humans power to rule over it on his behalf.
But the humans are tempted by this mysterious, unhuman character who offers them a promise. You could define good and evil on your own terms and put yourselves in God's place.
Which is what they do. And the resulting stories are about the broken relationships and violence that results.
Yeah, this promise creates huge problems. Now everyone has to protect themselves and fight for survival, and they're all using death as this weapon to gain power.
It all leads to a story about the building of the city of Babylon.
Or in Hebrew, Babel. Everyone comes together to elevate themselves to the place of God. And God knows how devastating this could be, a whole culture redefining good and evil as if they are God.
So God confuses their language and scatters them.
Now from here on, Babylon becomes like an icon in the biblical story. It's an image that represents humanity's corporate rebellion against God.
And the next time we see it is in the story of ancient Egypt.
Yeah, Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, he feels threatened by these immigrant Israelites. He starts killing all of the boys, enslaving the rest.
And this is really evil.
Yeah, Egypt's like this bigger, badder Babylon. They take care of themselves at the expense of others by redefining evil as good. And so God turns Pharaoh's evil back on him. His pride drives him forward, and he's swallowed up by death.
Now, after this great deliverance, the Israelites sing a song about how God is their warrior who liberated them from evil.
And the Israelites referred to this moment as the day.
The day they were rescued from a corrupt human system.
And every year since then, the Israelites have celebrated the day of their liberation with this symbolic meal of a sacrificial lamb. It's called Passover.
Eventually, Israel comes into its own land, have their own kings, and they face new enemies.
So that past day of the Lord, celebrated every Passover, begins to generate hope that God will bring the day again to save Israel from new threats.
Now, out in the hills was a sheep herder named Amos.
He was appointed by God as a prophet to announce shocking news to Israel, that God was bringing another day of the Lord against his enemies, and this time the target is Israel.
What?
Sadly, Israel's leaders had also redefined good and evil for themselves, resulting in corruption and violence.
So God's people have become like Babylon. The oppressed become oppressors. Babylon seems like a trap no one can escape.
And so the day of the Lord comes upon Israel. They're conquered, taken captive into exile. And from then on, Israel suffered under the rule of continuous oppressive empires.
This is the story Jesus was born into.
Yeah, in his day, the oppressive empire over Israel is Rome.
So is Jesus going to confront Rome, take him out?
Well, no. Jesus saw the real enemy as that mysterious, unhuman evil. The evil that's lured Babylon, Egypt, Rome, Israel, all humanity has given in to evil's promise of power. This is what Jesus resisted alone in the wilderness when he was tempted to exploit his power for self-interest.
But he didn't. And after that, he started to confront the effects of evil on others.
Yeah, he started saying that he was going to Jerusalem for Passover for a final showdown to confront the evil of Israel and Rome by dying.
Dying? I mean, that feels like losing.
Jesus was going to let evil exhaust all of its power on him, using its only real weapon, death. Jesus knew that God's love and life were even more powerful, that he could overcome evil by becoming the Passover lamb, giving his life in an act of love. And something changed that day. When Jesus defeated evil, he opened up a new way for anyone to escape from Babylon and discover this new kind of power, this new way of being human.
Okay, so something changed. But the power of evil is still alive and well, and we keep building new versions of Babylon.
Right. And so the last book of the Bible, the Revelation, points to the future and final day of the Lord. It's when God's kingdom comes to confront Babylon the Great, this image of all the corrupt nations of the world.
Yeah, this is it. Armageddon, final judgment. How is Jesus gonna finish off evil?
Well, that's not how you'd expect. In the Revelation, the victorious Jesus is symbolized by a sacrificial bloody lamb. And then when Jesus does arrive in the end, riding his white horse to confront evil, he's bloody before the battle even starts.
Pre-bloodied? That's a strange image.
Yeah, it's because Jesus isn't out for our blood. Rather, he overcame with his blood when he died for his enemies. And the sword is in his mouth. It's a symbol of Jesus' authority to define good and evil and hold us accountable when he brings final justice once and for all.
And so, in the meantime, the day of the Lord is an invitation to resist the culture of Babylon.
And it's a promise that God will one day free our world from corruption and bring about the new things that he has in store.
Yeah. So why do we watch that? So when you see something like Day of the Lord, a theme like that, that's a theological theme. Technically, it's an eschatological theological theme. So is the coming Redeemer. It's a theological theme. So when we talk about theology, systematic theology, it's what does all of the Bible teach us or talk about this one theme that we use all the way through. So when you see something like that, I love the way that video takes it from very beginning to very end, because that's what theology does. It helps us connect all these stories, all these themes, all these people, all these things into a story that God has been carrying out. And so again, like Wax says, what time is it? We're in the time where we know God is still taking this thing somewhere. So again, that's why we're doing eschatology tonight. But just those theological threads, when you see things like that, pull them and see how far they go. On page 4 in your notes, we get to eschatology in the New Testament. Not quite as mysterious or as hard to see necessarily as the Old Testament, because again, it's, you know, starting to reveal what the Old Testament's been leading up to. One of the big things, and I may have mentioned this earlier in passing, one of the big things that the New Testament reveals to us that the Old Testament saints could have never known is that what was thought to be one movement of God in sending his Messiah was actually going to be two movements. So it's a two-stage plan of redemption when the Old Testament would have only seen one stage coming. Does that make sense? So they would assume the Messiah is going to come, sit on the throne, and just wrap all this thing up. But that wasn't God's plan. That was their assumption of what God's plan was. So when Jesus came and crucified, that's what was so confusing. It's like, well, what just happened to our king? Well, he just started the work he came to do. He's not finished yet. So the eschatological hope behind that is that Jesus is coming again. And that's the second stage of God's plan of redemption for us. So again, it's that already not yet. I mean, you talk about inaugurated eschatology, the fact that Jesus has come, that's been completed, but he's not done yet. He's coming again. That's inaugurated eschatology, that category we talked about earlier. So a few verses here as we look for, where am I on my notes? Yeah, right here. So just that already not yet. 1 John 3:2. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet appeared, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him because we shall see him as he is. So we're already his children, but we're not already like him the same way we will be when he returns. So there are key eschatological themes in the gospel and in the Gospels and Acts. For instance, the coming of Jesus understood as the fulfillment of Old Testament prophecy, like we said. Beginning of the New Testament makes it clear the Old Testament hope has been fulfilled. I mean, the genealogies that start a few of the Gospels. I mean, it just walks you through how we got to where we are and how God has been working his plan through people. Matthew 1, 20 to 23, "But as Joseph considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son. You shall call his name Jesus. And all this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken of by his prophet." So then on page 5 in your notes, you'll see a list of other events that were the fulfillment of Old Testament prophecy concerning the coming of the Messiah. Because again, that the Old Testament was written to point us to Jesus and show us what God was doing and what he was going to do. His birth in Bethlehem, his rejection by the Jews, soldiers casting lots for his garments, the resurrection, the ascension, all these things were foreshadowed and spoken of in whole or in part in the Old Testament. So New Testament is the fulfillment of the eschatological promises the Old Testament made about the Messiah. But like we talked about the kingdom of God in the Old Testament, the kingdom of God in the New Testament is a little more overt. So phrases like the kingdom of God or heaven is at hand or that the kingdom of God had come, those are themes that you can start to see in the New Testament. So remember in the Old Testament, you know, God is king. The New Testament reality of the inaugurated kingdom is what's presented. So God's no longer just king up there. He's king here, right? So signs of the kingdom, you know, when you talk about things like signs and wonders, you talk about the fall of Satan, you talk about the miracles that Christ did, those are all signs that the kingdom has entered our domain, right? So those are examples of, the kingdom of God on earth. The preaching of the gospel is a clear testimony to the aspect of, or the reality that God's kingdom is present. So regarding the fall of Satan, for instance, G.E. Ladd, great theologian, he comments that the victory over Satan, which Jewish thought placed at the end of the age, had in some sense happened in the ministry of Jesus. So, you know, though his defeat was decisive, it's not yet final. So again, that inaugurated already, not yet view. Preaching of the gospel, forgiveness of sins, or other signs of the kingdom. Again, G.E. Ladd has this to say. He says, the presence of the kingdom of God was not a new teaching about God, because again, we had seen that God was king over something, right, in the Old Testament, but it was a new activity of God in the person of Jesus. So that's how we understand the kingdom is here, the kingdom is at hand. It's a new activity of God in the person of Jesus, bringing to men as present experience what the prophets promised in the eschatological kingdom in the Old Testament. So, the dual reality that the kingdom is present and it's future, that the kingdom has come, that the kingdom is in your midst, the scripture says, and you can enter it now. You know, Ladd again summarizes for us that the kingdom of God is a redemptive reign of God, dynamically active to establish his rule among men. And this kingdom, which will appear as an apocalyptic act at the end of the age, has already come into human history in the person and mission of Jesus. Why? To overcome evil, deliver men from its power, bring them into the blessing of God's reign, but it involves two great movements: fulfillment within history, which we've already seen in the life and ministry of Jesus, but consummation at the end of history. So it's already happened, but not yet to the fullest extent. Does that make sense? So when I say inaugurated eschatology, when I say already not yet, that's the kind of stuff we're talking about, okay? And again, it helps us make sense of Scripture because it helps answer some of the questions of, you know, what were they asking? It's like, well, where is he? Well, it's not time yet. You know, it's not time to come back yet. There's still more to do. So Galatians 4:4 tells us that the Old Testament time and prophecies have come to their fulfillment. It says that when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of woman, born under the law. You know, when Paul says that Christ appeared in the fullness of time, what he's implying is that the great midpoint of history has arrived, okay? So that that kind of two-stage thing, now that we know we're in the middle of something, we're not at the end of something, that's how Paul would have understood it. It's how the New Testament writers would have understood it. And again, like the Old Testament would have understood it as being a one-stage movement, now we understand it as two stages. So almost kind of like that framework. So you have, you know, creation, you know, pre-creation, only God, only Trinity, creation, and then we have the past age up to Christ's first coming. And then when Scripture speaks about this age, you know, they're talking about where we are now, right? And then the age to come, when you see phrases like that, is talking about post-Christ's second coming, right? So we're in this age. So the apostles were also in this age. The people in the medieval era were in this age. The people in the Romantic era were in this age. We're all in this age together. So until Christ comes again, we're in this age, but we tend to think, I think, that the apostles are here, and we're way over here, right? But what if we're here? Like, we have no way of knowing, right? We're told we won't know the day or the hour. So, I mean, we think, man, how much worse can it get? I don't have any idea. I mean, we've been surprised up till now how much worse it can get, right? How much better can it continue to get before it gets worse again? We don't know. We'll look at some of the historical trends here in a minute. But, I mean, you think about this. This is where we are. And this is all God has done. This is all God is doing. This is all God will do. But anytime we talk about what God will do, again, we're doing eschatology again. So that age to come language you get from verses like Matthew 12, 32, Mark 10, 30, Luke 18, 30, Hebrews 6, 5 is another verse for that. So it's important to remember, even though we're in this age, we're still in the last days. I mean, the apostles viewed themselves being in the last days. So we've been in the last days for a really long time. We may be in them for a lot longer. Jesus may come back tomorrow. We don't know. We're just told to be faithful until he comes, right? But New Testament eschatology looks back to the coming of Christ, which had been predicted, right, by the Old Testament prophets. But it also looks forward to that final consummation that's yet to come. So again, we're just right there with them in this New Testament, this age era that we're in. So the relation between these two eschatological stages is that the blessings of the present age are the pledge and guarantee of greater blessings to come. Okay, and all that points to the second coming of Christ. That's the key theme in the New Testament, really, when you think about it eschatologically, is that Christ will come again and wrap all this up and be victorious. You notice on page 7, there's a list of passages that show this clearly, which you can look at on your own time. You're probably mostly fairly familiar with the second coming stuff. But again, Christian eschatology involves an expectation for the future that's rooted in what's already happened in the past. And when we forget the promise of Christ's return in the future, it's easy to forget how we are to live now. So G.C. Burkhauer, I was joking with somebody earlier, it's like, if your name is G.C. Burkhauer, you're going to be a theologian. You don't have any choice. Like, that decision was made for you. That's just the name of a theologian. But he made this great statement. It says, the promise of the future is inextricably connected with events of the past. The Christian's expectation is a far different thing from a generalization like the seeds of the future lie in the present. It's something completely determined by the unique relation between what is to come and what has already occurred in the past. The whole certainty of our expectation is grounded in this peculiar relationship. That true eschatology, therefore, is always concerned with the expectation of the Christ who has already been revealed and who will appear a second time to save those who are eagerly waiting for him. So at the end of the day, I think the big encouragement for me, I think why I love eschatology so much is not because, well, I do, not just because I like to nerd out on Bible facts and all this kind of stuff. It's a theology of hope. I mean, it really is. It's a theology that is as much, if not more, centered around faith and expectation and hope than any other part of the things that we believe. Because it's all about everything else that we believe theologically is something we can kind of point back to, God having revealed himself. But eschatology is us acting as though we actually do trust what God says and things that haven't happened yet that we truly do believe him for those things. That's one of the things I love about it. So that's just a quick flyover with the Old and New Testament eschatological language and some of the themes and whatnot. Let's take a break for about 5 minutes and we'll come back and we'll start looking at a little bit more of the nerdy nuts and bolts of different views and things like that. So let's break until 7:42. Come back at 7:42 and then we'll wrap tonight up. Patty has something for you, I think.
Just a quick reminder for our graduates, if you want to come up, we've got shirts and hats. And then Daryl, who I saw come in after we handed out diplomas earlier, we've got your diploma too. So come on up here if you're a graduate. Thanks.
holding back nothing, nothing from you. All my life, all I know, God's been good, good to my soul. Mountain high, valley low, I'm not seen wherever I go. So all my life, all I know, God's been good, good to my soul. Mountain high, valley low, I'm not seen wherever I go. God is for me, He's not against me. I will hold to the plans He has for me.
All right, here we go, 7:42. Still got a shopper over there. Here's the thing, don't tell anybody, but there's still shirts up here, so even if you didn't graduate, you want to grab a shirt, we'll take free promotion anytime somebody wants to wear a shirt with the Roundtable logo on it. So if you don't listen to the Equip Roundtable, there are hats left. We would love for you to advertise the Equip Roundtable with a hat. So yeah, if you don't listen to the Roundtable, it's a podcast that me, Joey, and Lori Winkenpleck do together, and we're on break right now for the summer, but we have a good time arguing with each other about things on there, so it's kind of fun. Okay, in the time we have left, we'll look at some various viewpoints that are associated with eschatology, okay? And I just want to remind us, I don't remember if I said this verbatim, but there is no orthodox eschatology, meaning that most things, like 98% of the things related to eschatology, apart from, like I said earlier, second coming of Christ, things that the Bible clearly speaks of, don't pass these kind of the, what I refer to as the sniff test of orthodoxy. They don't smell like orthodoxy because they're not. So these aren't things that necessarily you would choose to, in my opinion, leave a church over. You know, if a church decides that now they're going to be this type of millennial view versus another millennial view, or they view, you know, certain things as being fulfilled or not fulfilled. Those are, in my opinion, again, you can do what you want because you're grown people who can make your own decisions. But these aren't reasons I would divide or find another church over, that kind of thing. So it's because they're not essential for our faith or the faith of someone else. So we can have legitimate interpretations of Scripture, and we'll see some names of people who are very well respected, or at least you'll have them in your notes, that come to very different understandings and interpretations of certain things, and they can agree to disagree and still be faithful, okay? So it's not an issue of truth versus lies. It's an issue of interpretation, okay? So look at some of these things. If you're kind of going, hold up. One, feel freedom to ask a question if you're not sure, but also just know it may be an issue of interpretation. It may just be something new for you tonight. So, you know, the book of Revelation obviously is the key eschatological text in our Bible, honestly. I mean, even though we've looked at all of Scripture a little bit and how it shows up, the book of Revelation is the clearest example we have of something that's completely eschatological in all that it talks about, okay? So you can see on your notes in page 9 that there's kind of four ways interpreters tend to deal or read the book of Revelation, and those four are the futurist, preterist, historicist, and idealist. And we talked about this a little bit in the story of Scripture, but at the end of the day, most people, whether they know it or not, and that's true for a lot of eschatology, is whether you know it or not, this may apply to you, is that they hold probably at least a combination of at least two of these views. So for instance, most will concede that a lot of what the book of Revelation talks about is yet to happen, you know, such as Christ's return. We know that Christ has not returned yet. So that would be a futurist view. So everybody at least has a futurist view of that, okay? But some of the book has already happened in the destruction of the temple in AD 70. Most people would concede that point as well. Not everything necessarily, but some. But even if one thing in the book of Revelation happened in AD 70, that means you're a partial preterist. So you're at least a partial preterist and a futurist. So congratulations, you got something you can put on your business card. A key text outside of the book of Revelation that affects your view of that is Matthew 24, you know, where Jesus is talking about the judgment of Jerusalem. So if you view him as talking about things that all happened in AD 70, again, you're a preterist. If you understand him to be talking about future judgment of the earth, you're a futurist. If you think he's telling just another parable, which some do, then you're an idealist, okay? So when you have those things, futurist, preterist, historicist, idealist, which I believe the definitions of those are in your notes, that's what we're talking about. It's how do you interpret parts of Scripture? And it's usually going to fall into one of those four buckets, okay? And there's, you know, substrata of all those buckets, because there always is if you peel back the onion far enough. But in general, those are the four main categories. So that would be something to just kind of test yourself. If you're reading something, if you read Matthew 24, ask yourself, do I think this already happened? Do I think it's still waiting to happen? Do I think parts of it happened? And just see what you think. Viewpoints related to the millennium. Here we go. I forgot to put up one slide. These are the three that get people tripped up because most people assume one at the expense of the others, even if they've never heard of the others, right? They just assume that the one they have is right. Because most of us, if we were raised in the South, we were raised in in an evangelical church in the South. So if you were raised Catholic, I honestly don't know what y'all talked about in with regard to this, but if you were a Southern Baptist or that ilk, you grew up, whether you knew it or not, as a premillennial person. Most likely probably a dispensational premillennial, which we'll talk about in a minute. But on page 10, there's a list of views related to the millennium. That's another page to kind of come back to later on your own, because it just gives you more unpacking. Pre-mill, a-mill, post-mill, all these have strong adherence today. They span a wide variety of traditions and doctrinal distinctives. It's not like everybody at Austin Rivers Bible Church is a premillennial, and everybody at Westlake Hills Presbyterian is a postmillennial, and everybody at Shoreline is an amillennial. Like, it's just not that clean. You know, it's just kind of all over the place. So that's why it's so important to remember that none of these things hinges on orthodoxy, right? Because you may get in a conversation with somebody in your life group and go, wait a second, they don't think there's an actual 1,000 years. They think it's just some spiritual thing. They're a heretic. No, they're not. They're just all millennial. That's all they are. They're not a heretic. Well, they think that, you know, the millennium is an actual 1,000 years, but all that's symbolic. Well, yeah, because they're premillennial. They're not a heretic. They just don't. They have a different category of how they view that stuff than you do. So that's where it matters, is how we relate to each other on a lot of these things. So the millennial views, at the end of the day, are going to hinge on one chapter of Scripture. It overlays other things, but primarily starts with Revelation chapter 20. And here's just a basic, you know, flyby of what each of these three primary views of the millennium hold. Pre-mill is that Christ returns before an earthly 1,000-year reign with his saints. That's an actual 1,000 years. He comes back. Saints are with him. That's when Satan will be bound in the future, not during the 1,000 years. He'll be restrained, but not completely bound. That's still future. And then there will be a second resurrection a second resurrection after a final apostasy. So that's a typical, if you're pre-mill, that's probably in there somewhere. Okay? All-mill. There's no actual millennium, that it's a symbolic thing. Is that Christ is currently reigning through the church. So it's not an actual 1,000 years, but there is a millennial aspect in the way it's talked about in there. Christ is reigning through his church right now. So we're in the millennium now from a non-mill perspective. Satan was bound at the cross, and that Christ will return for final judgment, but he's only coming once, right? Post-mill is that the church will usher in the golden age, which they would refer to as the millennium, through the spread of the gospel. And then Christ comes back. So again, Christ comes back after that millennial age has accomplished what it's supposed to do. So that's why post-mill. Satan is now, or at least is increasingly being bound through the testimony of the church. And then Christ is going to return at the end of that golden age. So don't know what that golden age looks like, when it happens, but it's kind of not spiritualizing, but it's just kind of a reference of, it's a time reference for what God's doing kind of thing. So the millennium is not a literal millennium, it's a spiritual thing. So, but beyond Revelation chapter 20, your view can impact how you understand other parts of Scripture. One of the clearest is probably the New Covenant, which we looked at earlier in Jeremiah. So here's three examples of how a different millennial view can impact another section of Scripture. So again, your eschatology does matter for how you understand other things, just like other things matter for how you understand your eschatology. It all fits together. G.E. Ladd, who we've quoted a couple times, he's a pre-mill, or was a pre-mill guy. He was a Baptist minister and theologian. So his view of the New Covenant is that Christ, by his death, has procured the New Covenant promises. So as Israel has rejected him, through whom they might receive the blessings as Messiah, these now have a spiritual fulfillment in the church, though they also point to the future millennial period. Does that make any sense to anybody? But, I mean, it's a great quote. You have to kind of sit with it sometimes. All-mill, Oswald Allis, 19th century Presbyterian theologian. He's the all-mill representative. His view of the New Covenant is that Israel, the true heir of the New Covenant promises, has rejected Christ and thus given way to the church as its recipient. Okay, a little different. Post-mill, representative would be Charles Hodge, who was a Reformed Presbyterian theologian. While the church receives New Covenant blessings by being grafted in, literal Israel still will be restored and will receive the blessings during the pre-second coming millennial golden age. So you hear that? So that pre-second coming, there's a golden age that they spiritually view as the symbolic thousand-year reign of Christ. So you see different emphases on Israel or the church or the people of God or the blessings or the Messiah. So their view of the millennium colors these other things. So why is that important to know? If you're reading a commentary on something and you're going, I have never heard of you like this before, well, look and see what else the person might believe and see if that is somehow impacting how they're explaining something in a way that you've just never even thought of before. It could have something to do with their eschatology. So if you look on the chart on page 8, entitled End Times Through the Ages, there's some examples of how eschatological beliefs have changed over time. Notes are a little out of order because my notes were a little out of order when I gave them to Brooke to put together, so that is my fault. But the chart gives you kind of a high-level overview of eschatology through the ages. So in addition to just kind of views of the millennium, whether you're Presbyterian or Baptist or whatever, how that informs it, the era in which you live also informs your eschatology. So for instance, the patristic period, which patristic father, church fathers, first 400 years of the church. So at the start of the patristic period, the early church believed that the 1,000-year reign of Christ would be a future, literal event that would follow his imminent return. That view is what we now know as pre-mill, okay? When he hadn't returned by the second century, spoiler alert, they began to explore the idea of a less literal interpretation for the 1,000 years, and that view became the all-mill view, right? So their context determined how they're developing their doctrine on this stuff. And then by the 4th century, they began to believe that Christ's kingdom had to have already commenced since he hadn't returned yet, and this view became, over time, known as post-mill. So in the first 400 years of the church, we moved from pre-mill to all-mill to post-mill just because they're trying to make sense of what God had said and what they perceived God doing or not doing, right? So then you get to the medieval period, 500 to 1500 A.D., So then you get, you know, what's happening then? You got death, you got disease, you got starvation. They were just a ridiculously hard existence. You know, they weren't thinking a lot about eschatology. They're just trying to survive, right, in the midst of all this craziness. So basing itself on the interpretations given by Augustine, the church understood the thousand-year rule of the saints as the period of the church's present existence on earth from its founding until Judgment Day. That's Dr. Spiegel that actually wrote that. So that view is now what's known as post-mill. Okay, so the post-millennial thing got a little more popular, one on Augustine's teaching, but also just on the nature of life during that period. So again, their context was determining how they viewed, it was informing their view of eschatology, so kind of what God was doing and where God was taking all this. Then we had the Protestant period, 1500 to 1700. And of course, you know what happened during the Protestant period? Anybody? Any church history people? Reformation, there you go. So the amillennial view was the view of most of the reformers, Luther, Calvin, because they were so impacted by Augustine, whose post-mill, you know, inklings kind of over time became more of an amill understanding. So those guys, greatly influenced by him, amill was kind of their view of things. But their concern was for the corruption of the Catholic Church. Well, what does that do? Well, that means you look at the book of Revelation, now the Pope's the Antichrist, right? So again, their context was determining how they were understanding Scripture, how they were applying their eschatology. And then we hit the modern period, which somehow we're still in, 1700 to the present. And there's a whole long list. So the modern period, we have liberal theologians that begin to reduce the Christian faith to just ethical philosophies, you know, looking at Jesus as a good moral teacher, not necessarily God, you know. It's like great truth, no real power, that sort of thing. So then the advances of science, you know, psychology, technology in the 1800s caused people to assume the world was just getting better and better. So the eschatological assumption was post-mill view, right? Because this golden age that the church is going to usher in, well, looks like we're getting to this golden age. Even though teaching and philosophy and theology and all this stuff's getting all wacky, the world seems to be getting better, so the church must be doing its job. So then the post-mill view gets popular again, and that the church will somehow emerge within all this progress as the great hope of the world, and they would usher in Christ's kingdom on earth. So that was the post-mill expectation in the 1800s, but then what happened at the start of the 1900s? World War I, followed by what? World War II, followed by Korea, followed by Vietnam, followed by communism, followed by all these different things that begin to kind of make us go, wait, maybe this golden age isn't exactly happening right now. So I wonder if we're wrong about this post-mill. So what happens then? Now all of a sudden pre-mill is popular again. And that becomes the kind of the general thought because, again, in the context in which we're living and the world in which we're living, so people begin to think that, well, okay, apparently it's not going to get better by us. I guess Christ's going to have to come back. And then the millennium golden age will actually start. So we must have had it backwards. So, and now you get, you know, 2023 and amill is really popular again because, you know, we kind of got through all that era and, you know, and then all the left behind rapture craziness in the late 1900s, you know, you get through all that and then pre-mill gets a bad name because of association with that. Now amill is popular. It just goes back and forth. It goes back and forth. If you read church history and kind of do a tracing on that, it's really fascinating to see and it's predictable. There's like a cycle. So again, kind of that newspaper exegesis, not using the headlines of today to interpret Scripture or to form your theological views by, but it does impact us whether we want it to or not. So we have to be careful with that. It doesn't mean we don't look to see what God's doing. We just try not to superimpose what somebody else says about the world. So, but since some or even mostly all, depending on your view, again, of what is in Scripture yet to happen, we can't be dogmatic about any of these views because it's still ahead of us. Somehow, in whole or in part, it's still ahead of us. So the last thing with kind of the nuts and bolts views is maybe at least one word that you're familiar with if you grew up in the South, and that's dispensational theology or covenant theology. How many have heard of covenant theology? How many have heard of dispensational theology? I figured more hands go up on dispensational. Well, whether you know it or not, most people in the South are kind of functional dispensationalists, whether they mean to be or not. Because again, that's just, if you ever had a Scofield Reference Bible in any church you were a part of or in someone's house, that means you were exposed to dispensational teaching at a young age, most likely, okay? Not a bad thing. If you're a fan of John MacArthur, he's a staunch dispensationalist. If you're a fan of some other people, they're staunch. David Jeremiah would be another one. So if you sit under any of those guys' teaching, you've been exposed to dispensational thought, whether you knew that was what it was or not. So let's see if I have where that is in your notes. I'll just trust that you can find it in your notes because I didn't write that down. But basically, one of the big distinctives of dispensationalism, without getting into the whole thing, because you can read about all this on your own time, but the biggest distinction for dispensationalism is the idea of a distinct future for literal national Israel. So if you have a view of eschatology, whether that's your amill, premill, postmill view, or whether that's your idealist, futurist, all that kind of, wherever you land on all that stuff, if you think there's not an actual specific future for literal Israel distinct from the church, you can't be a dispensationalist. Like, there's no way to hold those two things together. Now, if you read all these things and you go, there is a distinct future for literal Israel apart from the church, most likely you're a dispensationalist, okay? Again, you might not be able to explain the whole thing necessarily, whether there's five dispensations or seven or four or who knows how many, but that's probably the camp that you're going to find the most resonance with when you sit under that kind of teaching, okay? So I'm not saying it's good, I'm not saying it's bad, I'm not saying it's midway, I'm just saying those are two, or that's one view, and that's one of the primary things that without that, you either are or aren't kind of thing, so, okay? Likewise, you can't be a covenantalist if you don't see a continuity from Israel into the church. Okay, so just like you can't be a dispensationalist apart from a distinct future for Israel, you can't be a covenantalist without seeing the church as some sort of fulfillment or completion of what God was doing in the nation of Israel. Does that make sense? So those are kind of the two big rocks for both of those. A lot of other things, honestly, aren't that different. In fact, if you there's a chart in there, I think the continuity from like classic dispensational all the way through to progressive covenantalist or new covenant, I can't remember what the last term is, but I mean, you see as you get more to the middle, the lines between dispensational and covenantalist blur a lot because there's a softening in their understandings of how the church and Israel and all that work together. But those are all eschatological things because there's a nation, right? It's inaugurated. There's an already not yet aspect of the people of God. Well, then how do we understand the church? What Brett talked about, you know, so the people of God, you know, on the mission of God, empowered by the Spirit of God. Okay, so what does that mean? Now we're into eschatology. We just crossed out, or we just blurred ecclesiology and eschatology. Does that make sense? So, again, without nerding out too much, you've got some charts that I would encourage you to look at on your own time, and please shoot me questions because it's just more than we have time to get into tonight on that. But, yeah, so that chart is in there. What else is in that? That's probably the main things for that. I just really wanted to just expose you to those two kind of broad buckets. I mean, you've got, dispensational pre-mill, you've got covenantalist amill and post-mill. You can be a covenantalist to be amill or post-mill or pre-mill. I mean, it's all over the place. So I think Grudem actually does a pretty good job of handling that, so you can look there. But somebody asked earlier, what does our church believe and teach about all this? Well, if you go to, I won't name names, so if you go to some church websites, you'll see things like, would be a good example. Okay, so there's a church here in Austin, big church here in Austin, that on their primary doctrinal page, like if you go to ours, it's like we believe that God is one God in three persons, that Jesus is the, you know, Son of God. I mean, just very basic, you know, high-level orthodox thing. But there's another church here in Austin that one of their primary things, the belief in the imminent return of Jesus, the belief in a literal thousand-year millennium, the belief in the future restoration of the nation of Israel. You know what I mean? Like, that's primary for them, okay? That's not us. Like, you won't even find any of this stuff represented on our website. And even in our Constitution, you got to dig way to the bottom of it because these just aren't primary things that make Austin Ridge tick, okay? We live and teach and believe towards the fact that God is doing something in the world and we're called to be a part of it and we're called to be faithful until God wraps it up however he sees fit. But within that, there's room to believe a variety of the things we've talked about tonight and still be in fellowship and do great ministry together and maybe even share an office space, right? So a couple of years ago, maybe 3 years ago, I guess it was 3 years ago now because it's third year of doing this, I actually did a poll with our pastors and elders just to see where we all fell on this. I was just curious, like, is there any kind of linearity between us? And I didn't have them sign names, so I don't know who was Brad and who was everybody else. So, I mean, I kind of have a hunch just based on some of the comments. But that being said, here's some views related to eschatology that your staff, or at least the staff you had 3 years ago, was mostly the same now, held. So which of these best describes your view of eschatology? Blue is dispensational. Red or orange, whatever that is covenant. Yellow is new covenant, which we didn't even go into tonight. And then green is not sure. So you can see that the not sure, the dispensationals are almost neck and neck, right? These are people you pay for their knowledge, just FYI. I was actually surprised by that. I figured being a Bible church that we would have a much higher dispensational faction, because that's pretty much what Dallas Seminary teaches, and that's where a lot of our pastors have come from. But over time, it's drifted more towards covenant. Don't be scared. Let's see. Would you categorize yourself a pre-mill, an a-mill, a post-mill, or have no position at all? We had no post-mill. That surprised me, because a lot of guys that are young, and we had just hired a couple of younger pastors there, are really post-mill. That's a real popular kind of reform view, which a lot of young guys are definitely strongly in that camp. We had none. The all-mill view was, 35%, pre-mill, 52%. Were all events prophesied in Revelation fulfilled in AD 70? Y'all remember what term that was? Starts with a P. Preterist. Are you a preterist? Yes, no, partially, or no position. We had zero yeses, 41% no, they weren't all fulfilled. They were partially fulfilled, and 17% it's like, I don't know. Right? Is there a distinct future for Israel in God's plan? So this is interesting. We have 52% that said yes, but we only had, 30% that said they were dispensational? They don't know what it means, exactly. That's probably true. These people graduated seminary, bro, you know? But I think one of the things that reveals is they probably hadn't thought about it since seminary either. It's like, I don't know, I ain't even thought about that term in forever. Sure, no, you know, that kind of thing. Is there a tribulation? Is the tribulation a literal seven-year time period? Yes is 47%. Oh, my bad. Oh, go back. No, 41%. Not sure, 11%. So that was the most evenly divided, that the tribulation. Within that, is tribulation kind of what we're in now for the period of this age, like we talked about earlier, or is it something still to come in a future time before the final culmination of all things? Again, it's not orthodox, because we just don't know. Until God wraps it all up, we just won't know. Will the rapture happen before, during, or after a period of tribulation? So before is 35, during, so small I can't even see it. After, 17, not sure. I don't believe in literal rapture, 17.6%. There you go. Any of those concern anybody? Yeah? Well, it shouldn't. That's the whole thing. It's like there is no orthodox eschatology. That really is funny. My assistant, Brooke, when she did these slides, she goes, you realize you had the slide, there's no orthodox eschatology, like seven times in your presentation. And I said, yeah, I know. I need to kind of whittle that down. Because that really is one of the biggest things that in seminary, Brad, I don't know how it was for you, but that was one of the most freeing things. They said, like, day one of eschatology is that there is no orthodox eschatology. I'm like, wait, we're not supposed to fight over this? Because that's how I'm just wired. I like to argue, so I don't mind arguing about anything. And I'm like, it's not worth arguing about. I think I've showed you all that in the Revelation class, kind of that pyramid, you know, like the foundational thing, Christ's return. You work your way up, and the rapture is like the little thing on the top. It's like, that's such a debatable doctrine depending on how you come at, you know, Second Thess and how you come at Revelation and all this, that, the other. And so, you know, people will leave a church over a view of the rapture, and that's one of the least spoken about and least clear when it is spoken about things in Scripture, right? So what is our official view on those things is we really don't have one. And again, I hope that doesn't concern you. What's concerning me is my computer is not being nice to me tonight more than anything else. So the point of eschatology, we'll just go there since that's apparently where the computer wants to go. Let's see, where'd I go? Yeah, the three things that we need to remember about eschatology and its point is that mission, faithfulness, and hope. What does that mean? So regarding mission, that book by Trevin Wax, Eschatological Discipleship, that I showed y'all earlier, he says that if discipleship includes the mission of making more disciples, then the fulfillment of the Great Commission depends on faithful obedience to Christ in a particular place and time. So again, eschatology reminds us what time it is. As long as it's before Christ's return, there's still work to do. So good eschatology fuels the mission. It's not something that distracts us from it. It should fuel it if we do it right and use it right. Because we forget the fact, I mean, part of eschatology is that Jesus is coming again, not just victoriously, but in judgment, right? That's how he's victorious, is he judges the living and the dead. He judges the righteous and the unrighteous. So what's great news for us is the worst news possible for others. And we want to see as few people, you know, have to go through that as possible. So that fuels us. Compassion for the lost fuels our mission. But eschatology is what reminds us, to have compassion for the lost. Otherwise, it's just another Tuesday again, and it's just people that are like us and some that aren't like us. But, man, if there's death, right, eschatology, personal eschatology, and there's an afterlife, personal eschatology, and there's a judgment coming, you know, corporate eschatology, divine eschatology, if all these things are true, then it matters how we live and what we do with the time that God gives us. So good eschatology reminds us of all that. Hope. Let's see, I skipped over one. What did I skip? Faithfulness. Yeah, I think that's faithfulness. Also, the mission, faithfulness, I think those two kind of go together. Hope is the big one. I mentioned this earlier. To me, eschatology is just truly one of those things that it is the thing that we, there's just a faith aspect to it that to me is different in, it's qualitatively different than the type of faith we have in the finished work of Christ on our behalf through the life, death, resurrection, victory over sin, that sort of thing, because it's still out there. You know, that's something that, you know, factually happened behind us that we can think about and point to and read scriptures over, and they're clear. You know, here's what Christ did, here's why he did it, here's what it accomplished. But so much of eschatology is belief in, again, what God has done so that we don't forget God's promises for what he will do. And that's, I don't know, that's just, there's something in that for me that just kind of fuels me. I don't know why. I don't know if I've got something wrong or if that's good, but it just is. How about that? But I think we just like any other part of theology, we study eschatology to better understand who God is and what he's done and what he's doing. And, you know, what God will ultimately do is the point of eschatology, because it's the end times, it's the last things. And again, because he's been faithful to accomplish what he said he would up till now, we can trust him to accomplish what he said he's still going to do. Dr. Spiegel, one last quote from him. Kind of sums up that hope piece. It says, when we despair, we look to him. And when we grieve, we find strength in him. And when we lose heart, we long for his coming. And at the center of our hope stands not a promise, a principle, or even a prophecy, but a person. And, I mean, that's the point. That's the point of all theology. That's the point of every ology that we've talked about is, how does this point me to Jesus? How does this help me better see Jesus? How does this better help me understand Jesus? How does this better inform how I talk about and think about and reflect on and meditate on Jesus? That's what it all points to. Because if that's what all the scripture points to, anything scripture points us to, better point us to that as well. That makes sense? That's it. That's 8 weeks of theology for you guys. Yay, it's over. It's over. No, kidding. What questions do you guys have? We have a few minutes left, and this is your last chance because we're never going to talk about this stuff again. Yeah, I'm kidding. Totally kidding. Anthony Hokama, yeah. He has inaugurated eschatology, future eschatology. No, he doesn't have the various constructs in that way. The Spiegel book would probably do a better job of that for you as far as presenting like dispensational, covenantal, future, inaugurated, all those sorts of things. Yeah, that would probably do a better job of that. And if you look at that and go, I really want more than that, I have other books that I can point you to as well. Yes, ma'am?
We hold that there is in pan-tribulation,
all pan out of the end. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, that's what they all teach, right? Yes, sir?
Is there a branch of dispensationalism that holds that the means of salvation has changed in different dispensations?
So he asks if there's a branch of dispensationalism that views a different means of salvation in a different dispensation. No. Where that came from in Ryrie's systematic, I remember this because I remember, do you remember this, a specific discussion in seminary about it? There was something he said in the first edition of that that was just extremely poorly worded, and people took him to task over that. So in the second edition, they cleaned that up. But unfortunately, I think they sold more copies of the first edition, so that continued to follow him around. Pretty much the dispensational scheme, for, you know, just abbreviated, God puts man in a place of testing, man fails, God starts a new dispensation where man is put in a place of testing. So for instance, Adam's put in the garden, Adam fails, God provides a means of sacrifice, we move forward to Noah. Mankind fails, Noah prevails, but then Noah fails, right, as well. God provides, you know, a means of redemption, salvation, covenant, and we move to Abraham. You know, it's that sort of thing, going to Israel. It just goes on and on and on like that. So each dispensation is marked by kind of a start, a fail, a new start. That makes sense. Grit, would you say anything more than that? Okay. So the misunderstanding is that in the Old Testament, people were saved a different way than they are under the New Covenant. Basically because, well, if that's a different dispensation, obviously you can't be saved the same way. Dispensationalists still believe that God is always saved by faith. Faith in either God's future promises, like Hebrews 11 talks about, or in God's completed work in Christ. Okay, so I had another thought about that, but it left me. Maybe it'll come back. Did that answer your question, though? Okay. I probably have a paper on that somewhere I could send you. Well, yeah, I mean, it's a straw man based on something somebody wrote. They just didn't write what they meant to say. It's kind of one of those things. Because that was never the official teaching of Dallas Seminary, and that's where he was when he wrote that. So it was kind of like, how'd that make it past the editor? Same way a lot of things make it past editors. Somebody just missed it, you know? Yeah, that was the other thing. I mean, you think of dispensationalism, it's only a couple hundred years old. That idea didn't even exist until the 1800s, John Nelson Darby. But John Nelson Darby is reformed, so you know, here's a guy who believed in election, predestination, those sorts of things, and also saw that. So you can't have dispensationalism thinking it's another way of salvation. Salvation is God's electing power anyway. You know, those two ideas just don't meet up. So it was just, yeah, it was just a big ball of yarn that got pulled apart the wrong way. But that's a great question, though. That shows you've done a lot of other reading besides what we've done here. What else? This is the most fun part of the whole thing. Question. Thank you. Well, honestly, it's kind of one of those things. I don't know, if Brett, if you experienced it. You guys, if you've been in any higher education, I think the professors know certain things because certain questions come up. You know what I mean? Because, again, that wasn't my answer. I just remember that question came up, and there was a paper that had already been written, because that's just one of those things. If you know something in that area, this has probably spiked for you before. But thank you. I'll take the compliment. I can't remember what my wife asked me to do on the way home. I'm going to have to call her, though. So so that's also true. Y'all have any questions for Brett? He's just sitting back there completely unassuming right now. Guys, it really is just a joy. You know, this is tiring. You guys have committed 16 weeks of your spring to this, so you guys know it's tiring. But, man, every Wednesday night, it's just so fun to be with y'all. And I really hope that, if nothing else, the last 8 weeks have helped you ask at least different questions, better questions. I hope that when you study the Bible for yourself, which hopefully you do, and if not, I want to get you into a group so we can help you do that more. But I just hope you see things differently, maybe from different angles than you even had looked before. And if you do, then this has been a worthwhile endeavor. You're never going to learn all this stuff. You're never going to remember all of it. But, you know, just keep adding a little bit at a time and just see what God does. So let me pray for you, and then we will go home for the last time. God, thank you for tonight and for these men and women. And guys, thank you for the time we've gotten to spend together the last couple of months. And God, let's pray that it bears much fruit over time. God, may the things we've talked about, just may you bring them to memory by your Spirit when it's helpful and most needed and most necessary. God, help us ask better questions to see more of your truth and to see you clear and to exalt Jesus because of it. We just pray this in his name. Amen. All right, last time, you're dismissed. Sign up for apologetics. Get in a D group. Do all those things. And we're here to help whenever.